chapter 1, and the focus is going to be on verses 16 and 17, but I'm going to read also the first six verses of Romans 1 and then go to 16 and 17. And so if you are able, please stand as we hear God's word spoken and read to us this morning. And hear then what the Lord our God has to say to us this morning. Beginning at verse 1 of Romans 1. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, regarding his son, who as to his human nature was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was declared with the power to be the Son of God, by his resurrection from the dead. Jesus Christ our Lord, through him and for his name's sake, we received grace and apostleship to call people from among all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith. And you are also among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. And then to verse 16. Paul writes, I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For in the gospel of righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Verse 16, which we read of Romans 1, begins by saying, Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel. I am not ashamed of the gospel and what it is and what it represents. Now, we live in a world today where many, including us, experience shame to some degree or level. Many of us in the world experience times when we are awkwardly silent because we are so conscientious of what people might think of us. And so we stand off in the distance, and sometimes we stand in the shadows. We don't want to be heard. We want to be silent. We don't want people to look at us different. We are bashful and sheepish, embarrassed and intimidated, because we don't know how to respond to the situation. And so our embarrassment enslaves us. As Christians, we should never be embarrassed. We should never be intimidated when it comes to the person of Jesus Christ. We should never be ashamed of proclaiming Jesus. Our cause is too important. Our King is too great. Our witness is desperately needed. Would you not agree that our witness is desperately needed in this world? Would you not agree that our King is too great, and if we have an opportunity to proclaim Him as King and we fail to do so, we are no better than Peter, who denied Jesus in the courtyard and said, I don't know Him. We are no different than Peter. Our King is too great, and so we are called to not be ashamed, not to be intimidated. Now, we live in an age and in a world where there is little shame, if no shame at all. People are willing to say anything. They'll say anything in public. They'll do anything in public. You see people committing atrocious crimes when they know that there are people watching, standing right there. They'll say vulgar things. They'll have gratuitous sex and sexual acts in front of people, not worrying at all that people are watching. There's no shame in our culture. People will do anything today. And yet, as Christians, sometimes Maybe many times, maybe often, we are afraid to say anything because we might offend someone. We might offend them, and we don't want to be offensive. Let me tell you something. The gospel is offensive. Jeremiah 6, verse 10 says, God's word will be offensive to unbelievers. They will find no pleasure in it. And in fact, the gospel, the word of God, is offensive to us at times. It should be. It should not be just warm and fuzzy words that make us feel so wonderful all the time. Sometimes it should offend us. Because sometimes we also live in unbelief. Sometimes we also are on the path that leads to destruction. And so when we hear God's word, when we hear God call to us, in those moments, it should be offensive. Our heart is pricked. Our conscience is stirred. And our first response is to be defensive and say, no, I didn't. It wasn't me. But in reality, God is speaking to our heart and asking us to say, yes, I did do that. Yes, it was me. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. The gospel sometimes is offensive. But the gospel is also the word that infuses life into our being, the one that gives us new life. It's the word of God, the gospel. It's the new light that shows us the way, the new way of life. It's the same gospel that Paul encountered on the road to Damascus when he was confronted by God, by Jesus himself on the road, and his life took a totally new direction. It's the same gospel that the reformers discovered as they were reading Scripture, and they saw Scripture in a new light. And so they were willing to stand up and protest against the current church that they were a part of and say, we need to bring a different message, a message that is filled with hope, a message that gives life to people. 500 years ago, people like Luther, Zwingli, Calvin, Huss, and Wycliffe were not embarrassed. They were not ashamed. They were not bashful of the gospel that they had heard and read in the Word of God. They were not timid because they had received the power of salvation from God. The Protestant Reformation, which we celebrate today on Reformation Sunday, is the movement that marked the beginning of the church as we know it today. Not a church where penance and costly indulgences were required to cover one's guilt and shame. A church not where the only access we had to God was through the priest or Mother Mary. But a church where each of us have access to God through Jesus Christ and the work of the Holy Spirit. A church where we as believers have no need to be filled with guilt and shame. Because Jesus Christ himself offers us salvation. God himself shows us his love, each one of us, individually, personally, through his Spirit that dwells in our hearts. He awakens and stirs in our hearts the fact that we are loved by God. And so, this morning, I want to talk about the power of the gospel, the power of the Reformation, because this is the power that we have within us, the power that the church is able to use for the glory of God and for the advancement of his kingdom, the power that God has entrusted us to use. The word for power here that Paul uses is the same word as dynamite, dynamos, dunamos. And I don't know about you, If any of you have had experience with dynamite, any of you played with dynamite before? Okay, you're different than my church in Michigan. They all knew what dynamite was, and they all had dynamite at home yet. They used it to blow up trees, to uproot trees. They would dig a hole, stick a dynamite on three sides of the tree, and light it, and poof. Then they didn't have to call someone an excavator. They would just blow them up, the fruit trees, because every so many years they had to pull out all the fruit trees. And so they all knew what dynamite was, and they had all kinds of stories of the fun they had with dynamite. But they also had stories about what to do with dynamite so that it doesn't blow up on times and places where it's not supposed to, and that was to keep it stored in a dry place. And so if the gospel is stored and kept in a dry place and not released and the fuse is not lit, the dynamite, the gospel, is ineffective. It does nothing. And so we are the instruments that are God calls to make this power to be released, to have an, let's say, a Christ-like explosion. Okay? So the power of the gospel, where does the power lie? The reformers discovered that the power lay in God's word, in the scriptures. Because in the scriptures, God himself reveals who he is to us. And only in the Bible do we discover who God is. And only in the Bible can we discover what it is that we are supposed to be, who we are supposed to live like, and how we are supposed to live before the one true God. These words are living words. These are inspired words. These are words that are infallible in the sense that they will always communicate the message. And the message of the Bible is redemption, forgiveness for those who believe, for those who believe in Jesus Christ, the one sent by God the Father. It's a story of redemption. It's God's plan of redemption. It's from beginning to end. You read in the beginning in Genesis where God created the heavens and the earth, and he created man, and it was good, and it was perfect, and all was good, very good, the way God desired it to be, and all of his creation was designed to bring glory to him. And then sin came. Instead of introducing the good news to everyone, man introduced sin into the world. And as a result, we all live under the curse of sin, human beings and creation. And so everything got turned around and messed up and stirred up, and everything is not the way that God intended for it to be. And so the scriptures tell us how God is intending to bring it back to the way it was supposed to be. And we read through the gospel, through the story of the Bible, how many times did God's people fail him and forget him and fall away from him? How many times didn't God come and rescue them and pull them back? And we're thinking, how many times is God going to do that? If I were God, I'd quit. I'd given up on him long ago. I'd said, okay, off with you. But God in his love continues to pull us back and draw us back to himself because he has a plan. He has a plan for each of us, and that plan is fulfilled through Jesus Christ. And in the end of scriptures in Revelation, in the last chapter of Revelation, it talks about the new heaven and the new earth and the beautiful place that this new heaven and new earth is going to be. And that's what God is working at. And his gospel tells us that. And he invites us to be a part of that plan. And so the scripture alone is where we find out who God is. And that's the power of the gospel. It is the power for salvation to those who believe. those who believe by faith in Jesus. And so the only way of salvation, as the Reformers said, is through Jesus Christ. We sang the song, "In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my strength." And we stand in the power of Christ. We live in the power of Jesus. And so, when we stand before the Father someday, when He comes again, we come to Him and we stand before Him, and in our nakedness and in our sinfulness, in our unworthiness, in our dirtiness, we think, "Oh my goodness, I'm not worthy. Oh my goodness, I'm not good enough. Oh my goodness, I haven't done near enough. I don't deserve this." And so our natural inclination would be to stand back, because we don't want to face the judge. But when we live in the power of Christ, we step forward and we say, "I am a child of God. I am one of yours through the blood of Jesus. I am your child because Jesus died for me, and I love Jesus, and I love what He's done for me, and it's all because of Jesus. Nothing that I've done. It's not my works, but it's Christ's works. It's not my name, but Jesus' name." And we take on the name of Jesus when we call ourselves Christians. We say, I am a follower of Jesus. I'm a child of God. I'm a Christian, a Christ follower. And so it's through Jesus and Jesus alone. Now we can do all kinds of things in life. We can try to be the best person that we can possibly be. We can go to church faithfully every Sunday of every week, of every year, all of our life. And we can wake up every morning and pray and read our Bible. But unless we know Jesus, we're still not saved. Unless we give our life to Him and allow our life to be His life to be our life, there is no salvation. It only comes when we are connected and united and one with Christ, with Jesus. And so that's hard for us to understand. And so the third principle of the Reformation, after Scripture alone, Christ alone, is faith alone. We're saved by faith, by believing in the work of Christ. Not by works, but by faith in Christ. It says, "For in the gospel of a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith." And so sometimes I wonder if we get this wrong, and so we say if we live by faith, if we truly believe, then we will act differently. And that's true. But when we try to act differently in our own power, we're not living by faith. It's sort of like, I knew a person once, I still know this person, he's still alive, who would buy vehicles, would buy trailers, anything he bought, he would bring to the mechanic and tell him to check it over. Make sure it works right. Make sure everything is up to par and everything is working properly. And so he would leave it at the mechanic, and then he would take it home after the mechanic said everything was fine. And you know what he would do? He'd take the whole thing apart in his garage. Everything was taken apart because he had to check himself. You see, he didn't trust the mechanic enough to just go on and drive the vehicle and pull the trailer down the road based on what the mechanic said. No, he had to find out for himself. Now, faith says that we are putting our life in God's hands and trusting that He will take care of us, that He will do what He is going to do and what He desires to do. The Bible tells us that what God says He will do, what God says He does. And so when we live by faith, we are given this righteousness. And righteousness is not a sense that we are good, that we have done everything right, but righteousness is a sense of having a status before God that we are right with God. Now, I don't know about you, but when I look at my life, I'm saying, no, I have a lot of work to do before I can say I'm right with God. There's a lot of work that has to happen yet. And as I look at the clock and as I look at the calendar and I look at, I don't have that much time left. I better get at it, right? We all have that. No, our righteousness is what Christ gives to us. Our status with God, we stand before God, and through Jesus Christ, we are righteous by faith because we believe in what Christ has done and we allow Him to do that work for us. We don't say, no, okay, thank you for your efforts, but now I'm going to make certain that I am righteous. No. We believe by faith that we are righteous before God because of Jesus. By faith, we are made righteous. The fourth part of Reformation is that Scripture alone, Christ alone, faith alone, by grace alone. To the wise, it says, to the wise, to the Jews and to the Gentiles, this message has been proclaimed. To those who are foolish, to those who are wise. God isn't one who picks based on our accomplishments. We are saved by grace. Because if it was by our accomplishments, none of us would receive this gift. None of us would be worthy of God's love. But God shows it to us by grace. Grace alone. Grace is God giving us what we do not deserve. He gives us His love. He grants us forgiveness. He gives us new life through Christ when we did not deserve it. When we have sinned for the umpteenth time, and we've done it knowingly most of the time, and the Spirit finally gets enough oomph in us through God's word and through prayer to prick our conscience, we say, you know, I haven't been doing right by God. I've been doing this how long? And it's not what God desires. I need to change my ways. But first of all, I need to ask for forgiveness. And as soon as we turn to God and ask for forgiveness, He doesn't say, well, remember how long you've been doing this? What are you going to do for me? No, He says, just like the prodigal son, He greets us with open arms and He says, I love you. I forgive you. God does that, shows that to us because of the power of His love, and it's a gracious love. It's undeserved. We do not deserve His love, which is makes it all the more amazing, all the more powerful, that we receive something we do not deserve, and that something that we receive gives us life. Now, when I say life, I'm saying life that is different. As Christians, our life should be different than the rest of the world. Someone once said that we are like Sunday submarines. You know, submarines spend most of their time at the bottom of the ocean in the dark, just going around, and they come to the surface just once in a while. So we're like Sunday submarines. We come to the surface on Sunday. We do our worship, our prayer time, and then we go back down for the rest of the week, and we're just kind of going around doing. I'm talking about life where we are on the surface all the time, basking in the love of God and showering and sharing that love with others. Not where we go back down and do our weekly thing, but that we do something different. Oh, we still go to our jobs. We still go to our work. We still have our kids in our homes, and we're taking care of them, and we're busy. I know we're busy, busy, busy. We all are. But our busyness is for a different purpose. Our busyness is the fifth thing, for the glory of God. Everything we do, the Reformer said, we do for the glory of God. Why? Well, let's ask the other question. Why not? Why not live our lives for the glory of God? What other reason do we have to live? Do you want to live for money? Do you want to live for power? How much money is going to be enough? Well, what are you going to do with all your power? We look at the world around us and we see what happens when people live for money, for power, for worldly things, and how they chase after them, and how they never seem to be satisfied, how they never seem to have joy. But when we live for the glory of God, not for our own self, not for our own glory, not for our own name, but for His name and for His glory, let me tell you, joy fills our hearts. Hope springs eternal. Even when the world seems to be crashing around us everywhere we look, hope springs eternal. Now, a week from Tuesday is Election Day. And so some of you may be thinking, then we'll have hope again. And others, some of you may be thinking, then all our hope is lost. Because our hope depends upon who gets elected. No, I don't care who gets elected. Our hope still is in God, and regardless who gets elected, God is in control. Amen? And so we have hope. So live as people who have the power of the gospel, the power of what the Reformation talked about, that we live by the Word of God. And in the Word of God, we find who our Savior is, and that person is Jesus Christ and Christ alone. And that we believe in Him by faith, given to us by God through grace, in order that we might glorify God in all that we do. That is the power of life for us as Christians. That is what God uses to release the power within us, to change us, to transform us, to become a new creation. And that's the power He asks us to share, so that we should not be ashamed of the gospel. We should not be ashamed. We should not be afraid to offend someone if the gospel is offensive. If Jesus offends someone, that's on them. But if we fail to proclaim Jesus, and we are offended by the fact that we might say it, that's on us. Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. May that power be at work within us for the glory of God. Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come to you as the giver of all things that are good. And you are the one who has designed this powerful way of redeeming us. You are the one who has implemented this powerful way of redemption. You are the one who has released this power. Thank you for the power of your love, for the power of your word that shows us who Jesus is and how we need him as our Savior. Thank you for giving us faith, and thank you for doing it with grace, for we do not deserve it. And now, Lord, we pray that we may be a people who truly bring glory to you in all that we do. For your glory, for your praise, may we not be ashamed, but may we be filled with your power. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.